Scholastic Audio presents Out of the Wild Night by Blue Balliett. Read by Allison Edwards. It is good for a man to invite his ghosts out of the wild night into the firelight, out of the howling dark. A.S. Balliett. I am not what I am. I am what I do with my hands. Louise Bourgeois. Am I walking toward something I should be running away from? Shirley Jackson. Chapter 1. The Crier is Here. Ding, ding. My story begins at dusk. On the edges, by the shore, and around the graveyards. Let me tell you, this is a Nantucket November like no other. On the good side of being in my current state is that time works like the pages of a book made from fog or snow. You can flip this way or that, and things are always changing order, flowing, regrouping around the motion of your hand. On the bad side? Being dead. But wait, that may not be all bad. Being dead has its advantages, especially around here. My name is Mary. Mary W. Chase. Chase. As in run, I might be behind you. I died 100 years ago, plus a few days. Today, I was shaken awake. A tremendous rumbling, a roar of vibrations jolted me back from wherever I've been. I don't remember dying, nor do I remember what happened immediately after. I wake. I sleep. I wake, I sleep. Such is the life of someone like me. Just now, I was tossed back with no warning into the rough pitch-and-tumble world of the living. Wait, don't move. I feel danger everywhere, a rush of fear that we who've lived know well, an awareness that all might be over in a pounce, a prickling. Am I alone? I try my voice, but don't know if it makes a sound anyone else can hear. Hello? I whisper. Hello, hello, hello? Louder this time. A board creaks beneath my feet. I look down, but see nothing. I've been resting, present but not, inside the walls of my old home, happy in the familiar company of wood and plaster, free of worry, settled. Being a curious but shy soul in life, a watcher and a spy, I always did wonder how an egg could be so perfect and yet so easily broken. Life is miraculous but fragile, filled with risk and danger. And is death too? Ba-bam! Roar! What is the noise I'm hearing? Is it the end of all we know? Help! I gasp. If I'm already dead, why should I hold back? Help me, someone! I call out louder this time. My voice creaks like a rusted hinge. Does anyone hear me? Help! Two children pass by my front window. I rap on the glass, but neither one turns to look. The girl has hair like seaweed, all dark ripples, and the boy is the color of sand. Roar! The grinding and rattling start again. The girl and boy clap their hands over their ears. My heart sinks. Help, help, help! I yell, surely loud enough to wake the world. No answer. The children walk quickly and don't glance back. Now I recognize my fingers pressed against the window. I wiggle my toes and look down to see dark stockings. And there, my boots are by the door. I'm no longer invisible, at least to myself. But why am I here? It must be the children. I once lived in this town, and still do, although I'm no longer the one who sweeps mud and horse dung from the front steps of my home. My rotten teeth no longer bother me. I realize now that I'm back as the island's town crier, a bold job I was much too timid to have done when living. Crying doesn't mean weeping here. It means calling out. I'll ring my handbell for attention and shout the news through a copper horn. We criers can be loud. In my day, Nantucket had a living town crier, a famous and skinny man who walked up and down our streets and lanes, making an endless amount of noise. His name was Billy Clark. Everyone stopped to listen. We'd hear when a boat was on its way into the harbor, if a person was born or had just died, where to buy wool, fresh mutton, or salted cod. Since we didn't have any other way to share instant news, the crier was essential. In life, I spoke only when spoken to. I was guarded inside and pleasant on the outside. I kept my skirts tucked close and my hair pinned tight. My mouth was as small as a flounder's and my eyes were step-on-me pebbles. My entire family died one year in a terrible fever when I was young, and I was taken in by a grumpy aunt. I soon married a silent man, the first who asked. My husband, Daniel, was a lifelong fisherman who hardly noticed me. We never had children, but I kept that sadness tucked in the pockets of my apron. Over and over, I scrubbed and baked. I wanted to be heard and cherished, but wasn't. I never dreamed I'd become so important one day. The town crier. Am I back in order to warn? As I look around my home, the floorboards vibrate beneath my feet and the walls shiver. What monsters lurk outside? Billy, I call out, joking but not. You can keep your job. No reply. Chapter 2. We tip. If I had bones, they'd be rattling like dried beans in a bowl. Perhaps Moshup wants to take back his gritty slipper. As a child, I heard an old Wampanoag Indian legend about a giant by the name of Moshup, a man of huge size who lived on the mainland. One day, he got sand in his moccasins. First, he kicked off one to form Martha's Vineyard, an island close to shore. Then off went the other moccasin in irritation, forming Nantucket, which means faraway island. There are still quiet moments in my home. Almost too quiet. No creaking of carriage wheels or jingle clop of horses outside. And then wham! All shakes and roars. Moshup? Is that you? Wait. Let me peek from my window again. The street is deliciously familiar, and yet not. All slides fast, in flashes. The colors slipping by, impossibly bright and smooth, like boiled icing on a cake. I see the red of a ripe cranberry, the yellow of a Christmas lemon, noisy machines known as cars and trucks, new to the world when I was old. Is that what I heard? Nearby gardens look to be on their best behavior. Homes are framed by hedges, as tidy as a bridegroom's haircut. I touch the wooden silk of my windowsill and the worn brick around my fireplace. I feel the hum of living surround me. My blue and white teapot is still on a shelf. The old woman who lived here after me liked to watch for children and to bake and fry as I did. I can picture a plate of sugar doughnuts. We called them wonders, cooling inside the door. The kitchen has water that pours out in the sink, both hot and cold. The outhouse in back of the kitchen is gone, leaving small rooms for doing your business inside. No spiders, no cleanup. I love the boxes that make a churning noise and scrub clothes and crockery and even dry them. In my house. What a miracle for all who do the chores. But there are other changes that are hard. Back I go to the window and spread my fingers flat against the panes as the earth shakes again. It's time to step outside. I clang my bell and shout. This is harder than you'd think. As I walk down my street, I sense other spirits near me. We drift and bump like berries boiling in a pot. Man, woman, young, old. Beach plum, blackberry, rosehip, strawberry. None of the jelly jar labels matter anymore. Why wasn't that true in life? Being alive was pure magic, and I've had my days of marveling at it all. The wink of sun, the first pink of spring, a caterpillar with a showy fuzz of stripes. Those everyday joys are no longer mine, but I now have a task bigger than any I had in life. A deep water darkness tugs at my heart. Children have always connected with spirits and vice versa. That is part of what worries me. If I was awakened, was it to keep a weather eye open for all of our young ones? But what if I can't stop or change what I see coming? I ring and walk and am filled with dread, but I won't hold back. Not anymore. Nantucket is a little island 30 miles at sea off the northeast coast of the United States in Massachusetts. It's been famous for centuries. First, for those residents who chased, caught, and survived whales, and now for the dangerous game of chasing, catching, and surviving those who come to visit. Every year between June and September, hundreds of thousands buzz in by air and sea, engines roaring and smoke billowing. A few sail in, leaving an elegant wake. Despite the boats and planes, our island still feels remote. No bridge connects it to the mainland. It remains its soulful self, but perhaps most so during the quiet months. A large part of its fame and glory belongs to its old homes. Mine was built in 1797, and I'm proud to say it was old when I oiled the floors, replaced a broken latch or knob, and hung dried lavender in the closets. It's even older now, and it's obviously been cherished. Only caring leaves this kind of a glow, a shine that rises from generations of hands that clean, polish, and protect. Packed with human stories, these houses have outlived their makers and most of their owners. Like art in a museum, they are what remain. They tell us that everyone's life matters. Differences between the language in my day and how people now speak don't bother me. I absorb the changes, a little like your breathing air. And despite the shocking roar that brought me back, I'm learning to balance death with life, which isn't easy for most of us when alive. Everything that's me is here, although I adapt and change form with each passing second. I'm flour being rolled into dough, a late rose dropping petals in the rain, a cat pouring itself off a chair. From where I watch, I can see we've reached a tipping point on Nantucket, like the second when water flows from a pitcher. Whoosh! This means a critical moment when something flows in one direction and can't be stopped. Not easily. One after another, day by day, faster and faster, our old homes are being destroyed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.